Good morning. Did you know that 30% of the people are visual spatial thinkers? That means in a group of 10, you will have 3 people who are visual spatial thinkers, beelddenkers, as we say in Dutch. While our society, well, that is organized by rational thinkers. What I'm going to talk in this 20 minutes, and I'm going to try to walk a little bit and hopefully not stand too much before the screens, is I want to talk to you a little bit about what is visual spatial thinking about. I want to talk a little bit about the 3 mistakes these people make without their knowledge or without knowing it when they are at work. And I hope there will be some time for questions and answers. If not, please keep them for me today or later on. Let's start. What is visual thinking about? Visual spatial thinking is the first language all of us humans learn. It is imagery, storytelling, whatever. But most of us, when we go to school, when we grow up, we forget those visual spatial thinking talks, and we move on to a rational thinking style. A small group, however, stays all their lives visual spatial thinkers. And you will recognize them because they tell stories, they're using a lot of metaphors, and they have a very, well, storytelling way of telling things, which might become complicated. Let's have a look at this picture. To be honest, the translation beelddenken in Dutch, viewing an image, visual spatial thinking, it's not a good translation according to my knowledge. It's much more than seeing pictures in your head of working with pictures. If you see this on the left hand, you will see the visual spatial thinker. That's the one when you introduce him the word cat, he will look at the cat as an image. The concept will be directly an image in his head. While you ask that on a rational person, that will more or less see the words, the language. Whenever thinking style, as they call it, is your preference, that doesn't matter. They are both equal, when you look at it from a valuable point of view, but they are very different. And that's where I want to go and focus with you. I think most of you know this picture. And I think also most of the people in the room will see the old and the young lady. But if you discuss this picture with a friend, and you don't know that he's seeing the old lady, and you are seeing or describing the young lady, you can argue a lot and you will never come to an agreement. That is what happens with visual spatial thinkers. They see things differently. This brings me to the first mistake they make at work. If they are part of a team, they will themselves have the impression that they don't belong to the team, and also the team will think that they are not a part of the team. They will be perceived as problem seekers rather than solution finders. Let me explain how this comes. Most of the time, their story is structureless and it is a lot of chaotic, it's much more chaotic than most rational thinkers will think. The reason is that they're using as if they had a film camera and they are looking from all the different perspectives. And it happens for them, it's normal, and they think most of the time that everybody has a view of the reality, but that isn't true. So they see another reality, a 360 degree view from every object they see. They change perspective while they're talking to you, which means that if you're looking to, for example, the bottle which is here, that unless you know that the perspective has been changed, you will get another story when you see the back and you still see the front. But the thing is, they are not aware that they change perspective, so they don't tell you and you lose them. Let's take an example from a problem solving. In most cases, you will go to a step-by-step method. So you will have the problem, you will go to step one, you see a possible obstacle, a problem which occurs there, you will solve it or take it into account, go to the next step and move on to the end. However, this is not what the visual spatial thinks or what a visual, how a visual spatial thinker will solve a problem. This is what he will, or she will see. It's one frame where you see the problem, you see the solution, and you see all the obstacles at once. There are no steps. Why they are perceived as problem seekers? Because if it's relevant in their way of processing to start with the obstacle in step three, he will start talking about that from the first time. But if you're a person who works step by step and you are in step one, you're not looking and you don't see it. It's really, you don't see the obstacle, the possible obstacle in step three. More or less, it's not relevant at that moment. And I'm going to speed up because I see that I have 15 minutes. This is just a picture to show it. If you want to go from the red dot to the blue arrow, this is what a visual spatial thinker will see. He will see that there are three possibilities. You can go around and you have two going inside. While a person who is not visual spatial will stand here, have a possibility to go that way and move on to that way. So the image of the view you have is different. How can visual spatial thinkers structure their story? And there, for me, one of the suggestions I give my clients is to use mind mapping. And it's to use mind mapping to structure your story. And it is also a good way to be understood. But to be understood. But what I would suggest to the visual spatial thinker is stick to one sheet. You have to focus and you have to leave out all the details. Stick to the sheet and use your sheet of paper or whatever you need. Use it during your presentation to pinpoint it out, where you are in your story. The second mistake they make is that they never finish a project. It may be strange and it may look strange, but they're like butterflies. They have a lot of interests and there's always something else that they see that takes their interests and that keeps their attention or attracts them. If you say you have to capture something, you have to say you have to write down and start working it out, you limit their thinking and they perceive it also like that. Because in their head, and this is in their head there is a lot of information and every new impulse will be connected to another part of information. They see 32 associations in their head. And that's pretty fast, so they have a lot of ideas, and when you say you have to capture it, what do you have to do with all the ideas coming up? You can have, within 5 minutes, a lot of improvements. So there also, go to action means for a visual spatial thinker that you have to encourage them to write it down. Write it down, stick to your plan, you have made some choices, stick to it, implement it, test it, validate it, and all the additional ideas you have, put them beside your project. Don't take them into account while working. Put them aside and at the end you can use them as improvements or you can use them for other projects. But really stick to those plans, because as long as you stay in your head, you don't get to out of that ideation phase. This brings me to the third mistake they make, and that is they have trouble with any kind of authority. And that can be a boss or a team leader who's really managing as we say, with machtsmisbruik and uses his power. But it is also everything regarding procedures and structures. Trouble is that it costs them a lot of extra energy to comply to them. Because in lots of organizations, structures are really really heavy, they are difficult in practice to use them, and a lot of the time they are outdated. So they find easily for themselves a better or quicker way to do it, but then they don't follow your procedure. So if they have to follow the procedure, it costs stress. What about mind mapping in business? I think it's logical that the first thing you do is that you really are going to set rules and regulations on how you will do it, because otherwise you can't exchange your mind maps. And it's not okay that if you need a whole standard of information to tell how what this is all about. So what you do there is keep it simple, keep it straightforward, and then you can motivate them to really do it. And to finalize, I would say that it's all about people. It's all about communication, and it's all about perception. And do I have now 10 minutes? Well, then I saw the 15 minutes before, so I'm sorry that I hurried up so to. So it's all about people, communication and perception. So if you are aware of the differences between visual spatial thinkers on one hand and rational thinkers on the other hand, try to create an open communication that people are aware of these differences. That you know that everybody has to adapt. It's one way or another, but keep it limited that all people can cooperate to your projects by using their talents as much as possible, which is keeping or creating an environment where they can use their own magnificent talents.
Plenty of time for questions if anyone here has any.
Yes, feel free.
I have a question, which is what is what you see when you have visual thinkers in a group situation with who are supposed to be collaborating on the same thing? How does that tend to work out, and what are the ways you can overcome that as a challenge?
I think the first thing is communication, and know that there are differences between people, that there are different way of solving a problem. If I may go back to this one. Is that if you know that the rational people are solving a problem like this, and that people who are visual spatial thinking are seeing the problem and the solution in one frame and at the same moment, it might be sufficient to know that from each other, that you don't get annoyed that the visual spatial thinker is adding some problems. Because at the end, a lot of my clients are telling me is that it's so frustrating to see that 2 or 3 weeks later my solution pops up or is brought up by somebody else, and they just get it at that moment, while the 2 weeks before they didn't get it. It was a fighting, and it was a really lot of discussions. So they get frustrated because they can't explain it, apparently. But if you know that there are differences, and if you use visualization, could it be mind mapping or whatever is suitable for your organization, you can really force them to structure their story and take it from the beginning.
Saskia, maybe I missed it, but Hans started telling something about dominance.
Yes.
I don't know if you were left or right, Hans, but
I didn't hear
you telling it. Do you believe in left thinking and right thinking?
Well, to be honest, there is not so much scientific research done on visual spatial thinking. There is one, Linda Krieger Silverman in the United States has done a lot on children. And she starts from left and right dominance. On the other hand, I know also that the latest scientific results are challenging the existence of left and right dominance. So what I think is that we might having there to need much more scientific research, because yes, I'm convinced that there are differences and there is something. I see too many people who are really saying, now I understand why, and it's not me who is the problem, and I'm not alone, because they get really frustrated. But on the other hand, saying, is it left or right brain, that is the tools we have at the moment to define, and in the needling brain instruments is the instrument I use, but there is disc, there is insight, there you can see a little bit of differences. And then it's going back to left and right, but I think also you have to go further than left and right. Needling brain instruments is going to eight dimensions. Which means that, for example, you might have been two people who are on the left side, on the right side, but there might be differences. For example, I'm an extremely visual spatial thinker, But, and maybe you know Richard Branson, he's also on the right side, but he's more a visioner.
But I think the latest insight into brain research is that there is no left-right thinking, that's one thing, and the other thing is that there's a kind of master-slave relation between the right and the left. Sometimes the right is the master and the left is the slave, and sometimes it's the other way around. The left is the master and the right is the brain. And so the common myth that visuals are and spatial things are at the right and language is at the left, that's not true. Sometimes language can be at the right and be in a dominant position next to the left side. So
well, that is what I'm saying. I say that there is something like there are differences, what we call at this moment visual spatial thinking, and at this moment we say, okay, it's based on right and left hemisphere. I follow also that scientific research, so I'm not quite sure about that anymore at this moment, but that is the only research we have. So that's the reason why I should be very, very glad to see that that there will be more research and that we get more clarity on that one. Yes, yes.
What I like about mind mapping is that if you are a bit chaotic and associative, you can say, well, let's bring some structure in. And if you're very structured, so don't get any ideas whatsoever, you can say to yourself, well, let's get some ideas. And what I think the main insight is I got from mind mapping is that we have so many different thought processes, and that mind mapping is at least makes it possible to understand, to
sustain or support.
To support you with those different thinking processes, and it makes it more fun, because if you get stuck in structure, then you can always switch to ideas and vice versa. And that's what I love about mind mapping, and it helps people really to get their thoughts organized and also to get new ideas.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I don't care anymore about writing. I just think a different process,
yes,
and it makes a good metaphor if people need it. That's more or less how it is now.
I completely agree with what you say. I get also a lot of people who are new or just find out that they are more visual spatial thinkers. They come to me and they say, oh, it's good that I can read a lot about it. But once people know, okay, there are differences and it's okay and I'm okay as I am now, because a lot of them think that they are wrong and that they have to change themselves. So I'm a coach, so keep really understand that makes a difference. And as soon as they get that, it doesn't matter whether it calls visual spatial thinking or whatever. The label is not important. It is just the possibility to be yourself and to contribute from your strengths and talents. I have just one. Yes?
Okay, why do you mention it as false? The visual face of thinkers make false in different processes. But I don't think if you see them as equal ways of thinking, it's not a fault. It's just a way.
No, you are completely correct. I used to say it as a fault because it is a kind of awareness creation that I am doing, and that's really important for me at this moment, because a lot of people in the Netherlands, more people know it already. In Belgium, for children, you are in the Netherlands ahead of us that in schools you are taking care of them. In Belgium it starts and the discussion on does it exist or not is there huge. But what I see, and it's also my own story, because I used to work for large companies and I really get completely blocked and locked out and a burnout and all the things you name it, and I've got it. But that to create the awareness both with the people themselves, that you are perfectly okay, stop complying. Stop complying and be yourself. And on the other hand, to people who like HR men and human resources people and that kind of thing, to be aware. Be aware that if you don't change anything, talent becomes critical. So if you don't change anything, you will lose those people. And as Yeti is saying, that they have a lot of brilliant ideas, a lot of brilliant associations, they will be the future to change things which are running, which are now running not okay anymore. So they will really be the future, and therefore you should take them on board. What I see now is that most of them, and most of my clients ask that also, what is there an alternative? Can I survive in large organizations, or do I have to start my own company? I think we run out of time. I will take your questions during the day or later on this afternoon. Thank you.